Hello all, architecture is about emotions and so is Bharatanatyam. But why am I talking about Bharatanatyam? That's because today we have a guest who's a great Bharatanatyam dancer and also an architect who's completed her master's from Anna University and did her bachelor's from NIT Trichy. And in her master's thesis, she correlated architecture and Bharatanatyam. So please welcome architect Lekha Prasad today. Lekha Prasad is a graded artist at Doordarshan and she's received the Guru Pandanallur Meenakshi Sundaram Pillai Endowment Award from Krishna Ganasabha in 2017. She's a disciple of Guru Srimati Priya Murli, Artistic Director of Sri Silambam Academy of Fine Arts. Lekha is currently pursuing advanced intensive training in dance under her guru. She started her training at the age of 8. Lekha, welcome. It's so great to have you here.
Thank you. Thank you so much for having me here. And it's always an interesting topic to discuss both about Bharatanatyam and architecture because one is profession and one is passion. And definitely linking the two and discussing about it is always a pleasure to talk about. So thank you so much for having me here today.
And for all the viewers, you know, thank you, Lekha. Thank you for joining. For all the viewers, you know, she's received the title of Nitya Nipuna Award from Nalanda University. And I already told you that she's an artist at Doordarshan. So, and, you know, with such a good experience in dance and also doing her master's, completed her master's in architecture, the relation between the two, which is a mystery for all of us, is going to be demystified by her today. So I'm straight away going to ask you a few questions, right? So, you know, what is it? Thank you. What is it about Bharatanatyam that makes you fall in love with it? You know, you've been dancing since you were 8. So tell us about it.
As a child, I've always been fascinated by performing arts. So either it has been music or dance, I've always liked the idea of performing. So I think that's what pushed my mother to put me into dance classes. From there, I think my relation with Bharatanatyam has evolved over time. Something that started off as a hobby, and you know, as a child, you go to different classes. This was one of it. But over time, this has grown to be something much more serious than just a hobby. It is a space. Bharatanatyam gives me a space where I can express myself. There are so many characters, situations, and sentiments that you get to play when you're performing as an artist. And that's not something you get to do on a daily basis. And it helps me channelize my energy, my ideas, and my thoughts into one single place. And I think from something being a physical activity has evolved to being something very emotional. And right now, my connection with Bharatanatyam is something completely emotional. And I'm sure with time, it's going to evolve to something completely spiritual also as I grow. But something that keeps me attached with Bharatanatyam is the fact that it's never monotonous. Anything might after a point might get monotonous, but with Bharatanatyam, it's never like that. Even if it's the same item that you perform again and again, each time it gives you something different for you to see. You experience something different, and it's an experiment, I would say. Each time you discover something new. So that's what keeps me, hungry for more when you're dancing. So that's what keeps me attached with Bharatanatyam.
Thank you for that, you know, great answer. And I want to know about, you know, about your guru. Tell us about your guru. Tell us about your training. Tell us about your, you know, practice regime. Tell us about it.
I have started my initial training with Kale Mamani Srimati Shailaja Ramji. She was a French professor, and she in fact did her PhD and studied about Vaishnavism. So her kind of ideas and thoughts, I think that definitely gave me a very strong foundation into dancing. And she's literally groomed me by giving a solid base in Bharatanatyam. Now, currently I'm training with Kale Mamani Srimati Priya Murli. She is completely a versatile dancer, I must say, and she has definitely chiseled the dancer in me, I would say. She is the vice president of the Association of Bharatanatyam Artists of India. This is an association with all different artists, Bharatanatyam artists all over India, which has now expanded to all over the globe. So she is right. The vice president of that association. She also was the convener of the Natya Darshan conference. This is a prestigious conference organized by Kartik Finance. She was the convener for 2 years, after which she's received many awards and accolades, one being the Kale Mamani Award from the government of Tamil Nadu. She's also the artistic director of Sri Silambam Academy of Finance, which trains students in the traditional style of the Tanjore Bani being style in Bharatanatyam. So this is a very traditional style, as it has a long lineage attached to it directly from Kittappa Pillai sir. It has come to my Mahaguru, Professor Sudharani Raghupati, and passed on to my guru and now us. And so we continue the lineage now. And when I say that my guru is a versatile dancer, she has explored various characters and performances in group productions, I would say. And it's not just been different characters, she's also explored different styles of dance as well. So a very popular role of hers, which stays relevant even today, is her role as Indra in a production called Mamuda, where she used Terukuttu to depict the character. She's also explored styles like Tai Chi and Kalari to bring out different characters in her group productions. As a teacher, she's very patient and I think very generous with the art form. She's very giving. And one thing I really look up to her is many people come up with different ideas to, you know, have do this, do that in the field. But she's someone, if she comes up with an idea, she makes sure that she achieves it. And, you know, that makes us, okay, when we say something, we need to make sure we do that as well. I think that kind of a commitment to the art form is something I really look up to her. And when you say the word guru in Bharatanatyam, in Sanskrit, it means someone who removes darkness and someone who gives you light. So definitely she is the guiding torch for all of us in Sri Silambam. And the relation with a teacher, it grows. As you grow, you know, she comes along with you at every stage in life. So definitely I've been blessed with a very good teacher, I must say.
Absolutely. You know, it's so good to see how grateful you are to your teacher and how you acknowledge her. I mean, that speaks a lot about you as a student and, you know, speaks a lot more about her as a teacher. And, you know, you also...
Yeah, and when you said about practice regime is also... Yes. Sorry to interrupt you. You have asked about practice regime. I mean, everyone would say dance as an art form, you need to do yoga, exercise, all of that. That definitely goes. And more you practice, the better you get. But for me personally, what I look as the best practice for Bharatanatyam is to always think about the art form. And I really follow that, because walking, sitting, sleeping, there's always something running behind in my head about dance, be it a particular item, a particular movement, or it might even be how differently can we tackle something. So that is the kind of practice I feel that, you know, actually being connected with the art form all the time and internalizing the art form, I think that helps you, you know, cross the ocean 50%. After that is your physical practice. But I think connecting with the art form always, and not just during that know, those hours of practice that you're doing. I think it should be, it should travel with you throughout. I think that is the most important practice that I think I follow.
Great, great. I think that's a unique way of looking at, you know, a thing which already, you know, people speak about, you know, okay, if I would ask this question to somebody else, they would talk about, we do yoga at this time, we do this at this time, we do that at that time. But you're speaking about the, you know, the mental state, talking about how you have to approach Bharatanatyam from the mind and from the soul. So that's great. Apart from that, you know, you spoke in the previous answer, you know, when you're talking about the new form of depicting a character that was developed, that speaks about symbolism. So what is the symbolism factor in Bharatanatyam? Is it the Bharatanatyam is the precursor of all cinema? Is it as a way of acting through expressions without vocals? Because earlier we had cinema, which was silent cinema, where it was all emotions, which was all expressions. So is Bharatanatyam the precursor, and is Bharatanatyam largely about symbolism?
When you look at any form of performing arts itself in history was an instinctive urge of man as a form of communication, as a form of expression. When you say Bharatanatyam, it's been a very ancient art form and it's been completely codified in the Natya Shastra, which you can say is like the rule book of Bharatanatyam. So in that, it says that Bharatanatyam is a combination of three ends, Natya, Nritta, and Nrityam. Natya being just facial expressions, Nritta being rhythmical movements, and Nritya is a combination of the two. That is both expressions and natya, in the sense rhythmical movements. When you're coming to the concept of acting, it's a very, we had this very fun assignment in class where we had to differentiate between acting, miming, and abhinaya. Abhinaya in dance is facial expression. So how, when there was a lot of debate and interactions with what exactly can be the difference between the three, because when we look at it, we always look at it to be something similar, but they do have a difference attached with them, where acting, you do have the option of using your vocals to actually express yourself. And when it comes to miming, there is no vocals involved. It's completely using your muscular body, I mean your muscles, to express yourself from your face to your hands and your legs. But when it comes to abhinaya, it does not include vocals. It includes your muscles, definitely your facial muscles and your limbs. But at the same time, there's an important concept of rasa which is involved. Rasa meaning where the dancer feels an emotion and that is translated to the audience and they are able to feel whatever the dancer is saying. That's when it transposed as rasa. So when the dancer is able to reflect an emotion on the audience, that is what makes abhinaya more an emotion. So it's an emotion when one is proficient enough to express it, then the emotion is universalized. So that's what is the difference of abhinaya from acting, and that's what Bharatanatyam differs in.
Great, great. So, you know, is Bharatanatyam really different from, you know, other dance forms that exist in India? Is there some kind of a common thread which unites all the Indian dance forms? You know, if you link, as you already started to mention about all the performing arts. So can you tell us about this link?
So there are mainly six classical dance forms in India, where Bharatanatyam is one of them. And each style is unique in its own way. And they have their own local flavor and influences in every classical dance form, as they are from different regions. When you look at Bharatanatyam, the name Bharatanatyam itself comes, like it has three different ways probably the name could have come out. One being Bharata's Natyam, meaning Bharata is the one who's being attributed as the author of the Natya Shastra. So Bharata's Natyam. Another one being Bharatam, that is India's Natyam, so Bharatanatyam. Another interpretation is Bhava, Rasa, Raga, and Tala. Bharata. So Bharatanatyam. So these are the three interpretations of how the name could have come out. So apart from that, Bharatanatyam is a very holistic dance form. Like I said, It has abstract movements and rhythmical movements attached to emotions and expressions as well. So it caters to an experience as a whole. And when you say, how is it different from other classical dance forms? It is unique in terms of its adava structure. When I say adava, it's like the building blocks in like the alphabets in English, where you string them together to form words and sentences. It is adavas when strung together form small dance pieces or korves or jatis, as we call it. All the classical dance forms mainly differ in the nritta aspect or the rhythmical movement aspect, where Kathakali, when you see, is very prominent with its footwork. Yeah. And in terms of Bharatanatyam, the Aramandi, the stance of the Aramandi, which is the half-sitting position, is very unique to Bharatanatyam, where the Odissi has Tribhang, where it's the three bends in the body. Odissi revolves around that. Bharatanatyam revolves around the stance of Aramandi. Abhinaya as a concept is pretty much similar to all of the classical dance forms, because the form of expression is there in all the classical dance forms. When you see Kathakali, it does have more of footwork. It has more strong footwork, but definitely has Abhinaya also. Odissi is more with the tribhangs, and the bends are more seen in Odissi. Kuchipudi, on the other hand, is a more sensual dance form. And Mohiniyattam came much later. And it's a mix of both Kathakali and Bharatanatyam. But I would say Bharatanatyam, I said, is a holistic dance form which has seen a travel through, it has evolved through time. It has been a dance form which has been in the temples, which were performed in the temples. It originated there. It moved on to be performed in king's courts, like royal courts. It from there, it has come up to the proscenium. And now, because of COVID, we see that most of the performances are happening on the digital platform. And maybe this is there to stay for another few years. And we don't know what's going to happen after that. So this art form has seen its share of evolution and changes over time. But it has definitely stood there. The tradition has never faded. It has evolved with time. And I must say, Bharatanatyam, yes, it is a dance form which is unique to Tamil Nadu and Karnataka, but now it has become a global art form. And it's no more just, it's not only for that particular region anymore, it's become a global art form.
Absolutely. I have my niece doing Bharatanatyam in Punjab, so probably it's definitely not like a regional dance anymore. Lekha, I want to ask you, is there some very strong relation with religion that Bharatanatyam has it always been related to religion? Can it be independent of the religious and the cultural associations, this Bharatanatyam dance? What do you say about this relationship?
When you say performing arts, like I said, it is initially an instinctive urge of man. The underlining factor here was a form of communication or a form of expression. That is how the whole concept of performing arts started. And that has adapted with every region, every social culture and social aspects to suit the different audiences at every region. So the concept has been adapted to different regions from there. When you look at Bharatanatyam itself, like I said, it has both rhythmical aspects and the aspect of expression. When we look at the rhythmical aspects, it's pure movement, it's pure dance. There is no meaning conveyed there. So it is completely abstract. When you're coming to Abhinaya or expression, it completely depends on what you want to express. So that again, it can be completely abstract what you're trying to express. And when it comes to Abhinaya, if there is a particular auchityam in the sense, you do it correctly and there is no, you don't go away from the tradition, you can convey anything through Abhinaya. You need that auchityam needs to be there. That's how we call it. Auchityam, whatever you do, you can convey anything with Abhinaya. At the same time, it's a fact that we can't deny that Bharatanatyam has originated from the temples. It has been a dance form which has been deeply rooted to the temples and the deity. And in fact, the dancers of those days were considered to be so pure, to be married to the gods. And the composition, the traditional compositions from those years, when you see it even today, it is deeply rooted to the deities. It is extreme devotion, extreme love, which is portrayed for the deity. And whatever be it, Shingara, that is love or devotion, bhakti, whatever be the concept, the underlining factor, all the compositions deals with the Jivatma yearning for the Paramatma. So that's how all the compositions have been put across in those times. And in fact, Bala Saraswati Ma, who is an exponent, a legend in the field of Bharatanatyam, has compared the margam. What is a margam? The margam is a traditional repertoire in Bharatanatyam. So she has compared the margam to the architecture of a temple. She has actually said how you move from one item to another in a Bharatanatyam repertoire. That is how the architecture of a temple is also designed. That is how a person actually travels through a temple. So, like, if I could expand on that, she says, when it's the Gopura, when you enter through the outer hall, that is the Gopura, that is the Alariku, which is the first item in a Bharatanatyam repertoire. Then when you move to the Ardha Mandapa, that is the halfway hall, that is the Jatiswaram. Then comes the great hall or the Mandapa, which is the Shabda. And after that comes the holy presence, that is the Garbhagraha, which is the Varnam. The Varnam is the central piece in a Bharatanatyam repertoire, and that is, it's got a mix of both Nritta and Abhinaya, where there is rhythm, there is mood, there is music, and it gives room for the dancer for complete self-fulfillment. So that is where he considers it to be the Garbhagraha. Next comes the Padam. So what happens when once we enter the Garbhagraha is we enter the Sanctum Sanctorum, where it's completely dark. There's no sound. It's complete darkness, quiet, calm. That's how the Padam is. There is no beats and movement there. It is pure music and it's gentle music. So that is where the Padam comes in. And after we finish praying, what is the final thing is the Aarti, where it is the camphor. So that is the final tillana, where a devotee is able to feel that complete devotion with the deity. And you finish with a small verse, a devotional verse. So that's how the margam comes in. That's how you travel through the temple. So that is the kind of connection that Bharatanatyam has had with the deity as well in temples. So that's what I have to say about that question, because it's so deeply rooted to the deity as well. At the same time, with an auchityam, an abstract concept can also be given.
Great. I mean, wow. You spoke about the relationship between Bharatanatyam and architecture of the temple. I want to take this question a little further. Can this relationship of architecture and Bharatanatyam be used today for designing modern buildings? What do you have to say about it?
When you're an architect, I mean, you're always brimming with ideas. And as a dancer and an architect, it was always my dream to connect the two art forms, be it right or wrong. I somehow wanted to do something connecting both the art forms. And my master's at Anna University, Chennai, that helped me gave me an opportunity to, actually work on this concept. Because when you're learning Bharatanatyam and you're learning architecture simultaneously, you visibly can see a lot of connection between the two art forms. It's not just today that they're linked. They've been linked over the years. It's just that we need to tap that link which is there between both the art forms, because both the art forms have a very rich history behind. And over history, they have been connected. So I really, really wanted to tap that link. which was what my dissertation in my master's in architecture was about, to understand how is it that they have been linked over the years. So in history, how have they traveled together? And when it came to my second year and I had to give my thesis, I wanted to tap this link to bring out modern architecture out of it. Because when we say tradition and, you know, Bharatanatyam, you always think that, you know, the building from Bharatanatyam will be with all those arches and it will be a very traditional building. But no, I wanted to say that why not bring out modern architecture from Bharatanatyam? Because tradition is always dynamic. It's not that it's very old-fashioned. It's very relevant at every point of time. So that's how this whole idea germinated. So I wanted to abstract movements of Bharatanatyam to bring out architecture and the current trend in contemporary architecture being parametric architecture. I thought I would use that as a tool to bring out architecture. So I used the concept of pattern generation. So I abstracted movements of Bharatanatyam using a movement, space and time as my major parameters. So the movements are abstracted and I derive a rule system. So using this rule system, I have various patterns which are generated. These patterns are there. They are the abstract movement. But like I said, dance is both rhythmical movements and expressions. It's an experience. So now that I have my rhythmical movements give me an abstract pattern, I wanted to infuse experience into that pattern, which is how I brought in the concept of koshas, which is how the body elevates to the mind and then to the spiritual quotient. So this was very similar to the concept of Bharatanatyam. So I infused that into my pattern. I used the Alaripu to generate my pattern for my building. Here in my thesis, I was building a Natyalayam, which was a performing arts center. So I used the Alaripu, which is the first item in a margam, which is like the blossoming of a flower. So I thought a performing arts center and a blossoming of a flower went really well together. So my pattern was generated using the Alaripu. And the concept of the koshas went very well with the Alaripu, because the Alaripu is considered to be like that of entering a temple, and so is the koshas. So they went well together. So the koshas were overlaid with over the pattern of the Alaripu. And from there, my site zoning started taking shape. So I have my site zoning done. And what happens after this is the spatial planning within every block. There again, when you see the adavas are like the building blocks. And here spatial planning in architecture is like the building blocks for the site zoning. And I thought the adavas being the building blocks in Bharatanatyam, I used that with a very similar rule system to generate small modules. And these modules were either repeated, rotated, transposed, mirrored, and using that, a larger unit was formed. These units were interpreted to form the design within every block in my site plan. So that's how it evolved from being just a pattern with just cubes and cuboids into adding a layer of experience, and where each zone was zone based on the koshas, where you had Gyanamaya kosha, Vijnanamaya kosha, all of that. It was zoned with a particular, with a layer of psychology of colors also brought in, so that it makes it more evident for the user to see the difference from one kosha to the other. And from there, I think the design evolved into being a completely modern building, I would say. At no point can you say that there is no idea of tradition involved. You don't see any arches, you don't see any kind of traditional construction technique there. It's a completely modern building, but which has been brought from Bharatanatyam from scratch. So a lot of people have been there, you know, there is always criticism and appreciation about any project. And one of the criticism was, it doesn't look like a traditional building. Why didn't you make it look like a traditional building? But I would say it was a conscious attempt that I did not want to make it look like a traditional building. I wanted to break that, to say that a traditional cultural thing can bring out something modern. So that was a very a conscious attempt, and I think I pretty much succeeded in it to a certain extent. Yes.
So you broke the stereotype of that traditional building, took out the essence of Bharatanatyam and converted that or translated that into a modern building. I think that is a great achievement. So, you know, I want to ask, how can people benefit from your work? And, you know, what is the further area, the further research or further work that you're going to do in this area? What is the further exploration that is possible in this area? Tell the viewers about it.
As a student of architecture, you know, I had this fear about contemporary architecture, parametric architecture. I feel, as you know, student bachelor students, you always feel that something very difficult, and you know, that's got curves and all of that. It's very difficult for us to do. That's how I looked at it. But when I actually cracked the idea of contemporary, I mean, parametric architecture, I found it really fun and interesting. There is so much scope and so many things you can do. You can bring out architecture from anything using parametric architecture. And I think that is so interesting. There's so much you can do with parametric architecture. And for me, as after exploring it to this extent and many other projects as well that I did with parametric architecture, I really want to take it to the students. I want people to actually explore parametric architecture in this way to see how much you can do in it. It's just not about curves and you know, rhino or anything. I mean, there is much more that you can do in parametric architecture, and there is this other side also. I want more students and more people to look at this and say this is another interpretation. I wouldn't say right or wrong, because I have been, it was part of our education system in Anna University. So this, there, no way can that be wrong. It was a very different insight into parametric architecture. And I think I really enjoyed it. So I will look at taking this to more people and more students. I have published a paper on this process of using Bharatanatyam and bringing it into architecture. But on the academical front, I would want to take it to more people. That's what I look at. Because we had very interesting projects in our masters where we had movie abstractions using parametric architecture. We had games where we had to take traditional games and bring it into architecture. So it was very, very interesting. And I I want more people to look at it. So I think that's what I see in future. I want to take it to more students.
Right. So for all the viewers who are watching this video, there's a link in the description of, you know, Introduction to Parametric Architecture. And also there's a link to the paper on Bharatanatyam and architecture written by architect Lekha Prasad. And ma'am, I want to, you know, now talk to you about, you know, like you said that you took the stereotype of tradition away, and you made a modern building out of it. So somewhere, do you think that people are kind of moving away from Indian classical dance, Indian tradition, or do you think this is kind of losing its sheen? Is it the time that it should be rediscovered? What do you think is the way forward?
I think that's a common question that, you know, many people have, to say that is tradition losing its sheen? Are we like, is it out of fashion? I think tradition is dynamic and it can never go out of fashion. When we say classical dance, classical music, it is a classic, which is why it never goes out of trend. It's never out of fashion. The number of dancers and the number of musicians that are coming in today as youngsters, the number is only increasing. And the kind of competition and the kind of interest that lies in youngsters is only increasing. And that's definitely not, we can never say that tradition is losing its sheen. That is definitely not the case. For me, as an architect, I still want to pursue dance. I still want to take that as a, you know, it's not a hobby anymore. It's almost another profession. So I think it's not just me. There are so many in my dance class who have done research in biology, who have done research in mathematics and still they pursue dance. And in fact, we had a diplomat in our class who was actually working for the council in for America. And she'd come to India and come to our class. And I must say the kind of passion and interest that she had. And in 1.5 to 2 years, she was able to complete her Arangetram, if not full scale, but I mean, for someone who's not Indian, and she's able to adapt to the style with just sheer interest and passion for the art form. I think, I don't see at no place for me that tradition is losing its sheen. I think you should answer this question now, because with you're saying your own niece is learning it when she is the younger generation, when she is exposed to so many different modern things outside, she's willing to learn a traditional art form. There's so much research which is going on in tradition, which shows benefits with what people get with learning traditional art forms. And the number is only increasing, and I think it's going to flourish only because it's just getting bigger and bigger.
Wow, wow. I mean, great answer and great insight. I mean, when you look at it, you know, the question is, maybe the question is stereotyped rather than the answer to it. You know, maybe like too many people are questioning whether tradition is losing its sheen. But as you said correctly, that tradition is a dynamic phenomena. It's not something that is static. It keeps on evolving, and we keep on having tradition as we keep moving on. So, you know, today, Lekha, you've answered a lot of great questions for all of us. And, you know, you've been one of the best speakers that we've had on this show. You know, you've spoken about Bharatanatyam and its relation to architecture. You've spoken about your journey into Bharatanatyam. You've spoken about the symbolism of Bharatanatyam, how there are so many other dance forms, which are the Indian classical dance forms, and how they're related to Bharatanatyam, and what is the commonality that all of them have. You know, you've spoken about your thesis project, and, you know, the great description that you gave about how the temple architecture and Bharatanatyam are so much interlinked to each other. You know, it was great listening to whatever you said. Now I want to request you, if you could, you know, give a message to all our viewers today.
I mean, from the questions that I first would like to say that you've come up with really interesting questions to answer. And I think you have done your bit of research in Bharatanatyam as well before this interview. So I must say you've brought up really interesting questions, and that's kept me grooved to actually answer it. And it's always a pleasure to speak about the art form and architecture. So that has been a pleasure. I only would like to say that art form and performing arts is constantly redefined, yet they maintain their essence, and it needs an audience and sahridaya, that we call it. We need an audience, and the sadhana needs to be there, that is constant practice and emotion attached to the art form, and passion for the art form is necessary. And tradition, I would like to reiterate, it is dynamic, and no way does it fade away with time. If you're talking about tradition even today, it's only because it has stood the test of time over the generations. And even today, it is practiced, which shows the depth of the art form. And there is so much that we can explore with Bharatanatyam and architecture, both being such historical and ancient art forms. And I just hope that, you know, there's so much more research and experiments done on this to bring out more interesting architecture in future.
Right. I mean, you know, I feel so lucky today because, you know, this interview that I'm having with you, probably my children are going to read about you in the GK books. So, you know, in the general knowledge books about how you became a great dancer. And, you know, I really mean it. I mean, I feel lucky that you're here and you're such a great speaker, and, you know, with such an accomplished dancer that you are, and you've also done architecture, and, you know, all those things combined, it's really, really great to have you in the show, and the great insight that you have shared with all of us on Bharatanatyam. And, you know, like, there's so many things that I learned today about Indian dance art forms, about Bharatanatyam, about temple architecture, about parametric architecture, which probably was not even planned for today. But thank you so much for, you know, talking about it and how we can use so many concepts, Indian traditional concepts, into architecture. I'm sure everybody who's watching this has learned something great today. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for having me. Thank you.
Thank you.